This is what we call the International Summer School Starter Kit. And primarily, what we're talking about is the global unions. Now we're all, if we're members of a union, we're members of a global union. And there are two different sorts of global unions. There are what we call the global union federations, which we'll explain in a moment, and then there's the International Trade Union Confederation, the ITUC. You'll hear of these terms, if you haven't heard them before, you're going to hear them during the week, quite a lot. Okay, so the global union federations are based on the industry or the sector you're working in. And you actually are members of it. You may not know this, but you are members of this global union federation. So a little tiny bit of your union subscription goes from your union to a global union federation so that you are members of that. And there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 major global union federations. There are some very, very obscure little ones as well, but I won't bother with those. But these are the main ones that you may well come across, and you're probably a member of one of these. So you have the Building and Woodworkers International, which I'll talk about more in a moment. You have Education International, which I'll talk about more in a moment. Then you have Industrial, which is a strange... I hate it when unions don't give themselves a proper name. They call themselves silly names, like Industrial, what does that mean? Or Prospect, what does that mean? Or, you know, whatever it might be, right? I much prefer it when they actually say what they mean, like the International Transport Workers Federation. You know what that means, that's clear. So anyway, Industrial is the big global union federation that was the result of a merger between the Chemicals, Energy and Mining Federation, the Metal Engineering Federation, and the Textile and Garments Federation. So it sees itself as the union covering basically private sector manufacturing of one form or another. You have the International Federation of Journalists, self-explanatory, the International Transport Workers Federation, the International Union of Food Workers, Public Services International, and then another one with a strange name, because it's simply called Uni Global Union. And that is a result of a merger between sort of white-collar technicians, managers, that sort of thing, media and entertainment, graphical workers, and communications. In fact, it covers a lot more than that. But basically, it's private sector services, right, which is covered by Uni Global Union. Greetings. Hello, Celia. Welcome, everybody. Just let you settle down. Hi. Nice to see you, Ian.
Hi, Dave.
Okay, so these are the global union federations, and you are almost certainly a member of one of these. I'm just going to go through a few of them in a little bit more detail, because these are the ones that are actively supporting the summer school, and for a lot of you, you will have come from these. You would have been nominated by your global union to come to the summer school. So you first of all got the Building and Woodworkers International, BWI, and this is basically the International Union Federation for Construction Industry and the Wood Industry. Based in Geneva, organises in building materials, wood, forestry, all those sort of things. And it has 350 unions, members of it, representing, in theory at least, 12 million workers in 135 countries. Okay? Then you have Education International, which of course covers everybody in the teaching professions of one form or another. And some of you come from Education International. Founded in 1993, actually as a merger between much older international federations covering teachers, 400 unions representing 30 million workers around the world. And I think it's true, it describes itself as the biggest of the global union federations. And it's based in Brussels. How many people here from EI? 1, 2, 3, probably more to come. Okay. Then you have the IUF, the International Union of Food Workers, or, and I normally get this as a quiz question I never get it right. Its official title is the International Union of Food, Agricultural, Hotel, Restaurant, Catering, Tobacco and Allied Workers Associations, almost always known as the IUF. Founded in 1920, and in fact many of its part of it goes back way before that, 336 unions affiliated in 120 countries, 12 million workers represented, and is based in Geneva, in Switzerland. And Dan here was for 25 years, is that right?
29
years the General Secretary of the International Union of Food Workers. So we're very close to that. The International Transport Workers Federation, a very old one, 1896 it was founded. Who's a member of the ITF? One, two, three, four? Should be more than that, there should be. Some of you don't even know that you are members of the ITF. Based in London, and of course it organises everybody involved in the transport industry. And it has 681 unions representing 4.5 million workers in 148 countries. And then PSI, Public Services International, which, how many of you are representing PSI? Well, yes, yes, good. Public Service International, which of course, as it sounds, is the International Federation for the Public Services, based in France, in Ferney. In fact, it's really based in Geneva, it's across the border. They're based in Ferney because they're cheap, right? It's cheaper to be in France than it is in Geneva, so what you do is you build your headquarters literally just across the border, so you can pretend you're in France, but really you're in Geneva. And organises right across all the different public services. 20 million workers, represented by 669 unions in 154 countries. How many, all of these, not just the PSI, how many of these millions and millions of workers that are members actually know that they're members is a very big question, but that's for discussion later. Okay, so what do these do? First of all, they support international organising. And as we're going to be talking about all week, because we are now living in a global economy, in a global culture, in a global society, the key role of global union federations these days is how to organise across borders, how to organise internationally, particularly when it comes to transnational corporations. So how do you organise effectively? And these days, it used to be, years ago, it used to be simply people worried about that in like the car industry, big motor companies or whatever it might be. People in public services thought, oh no, that's nothing to do with me. We don't work for transnational corporations. But these days, of course, everybody is now touched by transnational corporations, whatever industry you're in. It coordinates solidarity actions. So, you know, if a union is in serious problems, it's a massive strike, or it's being repressed by a government, or by an employer, or whatever it might be, and it calls for support from other countries, it is the global union federations that will organise that. It does trade union development and education. So particularly in those countries where maybe the trade union movement is weak or new or suffers from particular problems of government repression or whatever it might be and needs support to develop, to grow, to build, then the global union federations have all sorts of different programs which are to provide training and support for activists in those unions to help build the unions. It also represents our interests, depending on which sector we're in all sorts of international bodies. So most industries, of course, they have international employer organisations, and you have to have there's levels of negotiation and dialogue with employers' associations that you have to do, but also with United Nations groups. So, of course, we'll talk about the International Labour Organization itself in a minute, but there are many different UN, United Nations bodies that deal with things that we're interested in. So, for example, if you're a teacher, if you're in a teachers' union, then you have a strong relationship with UNESCO, which is the United Nations body that deals with education. If you're part of the food industry and you're part of the IUF, you deal with the FAO, the Food and Agriculture Organization of the United Nations. So there's a lot of work that's done simply representing our interests at the high level at the UN. Then it does campaigns, we'll hear a lot about that. It does research, and also it simply provides support for information exchange. So there you are in the UK, you're in a factory in the UK, and you want to find out about what's happening in a factory in Argentina or in South Africa or whatever, you can go to a Global Union Federation and say, how do I find out information from that part of the world? And that will help you do that. Okay, now, those were the Global Union Federations. You've also got the International Trade Union Confederation, the ITUC. And this is basically the international organisation of national trade union centres. So, in England, in Britain, soon to be England, actually, given the way things are going, in Britain, we have the Trade Union Congress, which is our national centre. So all the unions are members of the TUC. And the TUC is then a member of the ITUC. If you're in the Philippines, then the TUCP, or Centro, or other national centres are represented at the level of the ITUC. If you're in India, you have national centres that are represented in the ITUC. In every country, there is a national centre, right? And they all gather together at the ITUC. Now, they don't deal so much with industry. They are much more about relationships with governments and with international governmental organisations. A bit more of that in a minute. The ITUC is relatively new as an organisation. It was founded in 2006, and it was the result of the merger of two former other federations, which I'm going to talk about in a minute. And Dan and I, in 2006, we shared a bottle of champagne because there was 1 hour, was it 1 hour or one afternoon?
One night,
where these organisations no longer existed because they had dissolved themselves, that's right. And this yet didn't exist, because it was the following morning that it was supposed to take place. So Dan and I celebrated the fact that had no international federation whatsoever, with a bottle of champagne. Okay, where did the ITUC come from? Well, it came from these two federations. One was called the International Confederation of Free Trade Unions. And this basically was a social democratic or democratic socialist political organization. It was the largest of the global, international federations of national centers. And it merged with an organization called the World Confederation of Labor, the WCL, which was also a very old organization, which was primarily Christian. It was based on those unions that around the world that declared themselves to be Christian unions, mostly Catholic. And you would have priests at their conventions and their congresses and so on. Anyway, over years, they came together more and more and eventually merged to form the ITUC. Okay, so what does the ITUC do? As I said, it really represents trade unions' interests at the international level, with UN bodies, with things like the World Trade Organization, the International Monetary Fund, the International Labour Organization. In other words, in the same way as national centres, its primary role is representing our interest to government. Right? This represents our interests, we hope, to the international elements of government. It campaigns in broad sense for workers' rights. It coordinates solidarity actions against trade union repression, not specific to any sector, but when you get countries where the government is repressing trade unions in general, then it will organise campaigns against that repression. I mean, that might include places like Colombia, for example, where we know horrific level of violence perpetrated against the trade union movement, or China, where there is no democratic trade union movement, it's controlled by the Communist Party, or other countries that we know of. Where it's trade unions are either banned or they are heavily repressed or controlled. So the job of the ITUC in this case is to campaign to give freedom for the trade union movement. They do research and union development, and a lot of what they do is around the concept of decent work. Some of you may have heard of that before, you will no doubt hear of it again. It's generally the term that is used which says what we aspire to as workers, i.e. you know, you have decent wages, you have decent conditions, you have rights, you can be a member of a trade union, and so on and so forth. And you have a pension, and you have all sorts of other things. That's called, in their terms, decent work. Now, it's worth mentioning that there is another federation covering international trade union movement called the World Federation of Trade Unions. And this originates from the communist parties of around the world, and particularly the Soviet bloc. And of course, it was emerged at a time in 1945 when the world was separating into what was becoming the Cold War. Although its history goes back way before that, and roots right back in what's called the Profintern in 1922, which is basically about the Communist Party in Russia, Lenin and so on, and they're wanting to have their own trade union arm. Very much controlled originally, at least, by the Communist Parties around the world. It almost disappeared after the Berlin Wall collapsed. Many of us thought that that's it, you'd never hear of the WFTU again. But it has staggered on. And it's currently based in Greece, headquarters in Athens, where Greece has a very large Communist Party dominated trade union movement, trade union federation. And that's where they now host the WFTU. We can talk about that more during the week if you're interested. There's a lot of history to be discussed. Okay, and there is a bit of a sign that the WFTU may be undergoing a bit of resurgence in some countries. Obviously, what's happened in the last 10, 20 years, I mean, the crises that have happened around, you know, the finance crisis and banking crises and all these other things, and the incredible level of repression that we're all feeling as a result of neoliberal economic policy and so on, means that some people are looking for a more radical political alternative to the ones that are being offered by the ITUC and other, what we might call, conventional trade union federations. So they're looking for an alternative, and some are looking for that alternative within the WFTU. So, for example, some of the South African trade unions are looking there. We can talk about that more too. Right, all the global unions, both the global union federations and the ITUC and so on, they all have regional structures. So if you're in Africa or Asia or Latin America, you probably, your first experience of dealing with these organisations may be through their regional organisations, which we'll talk about a bit further later in the week. And then, of course, you've got the International Labour Organisation. Now, this is a picture of the International Labour Organisation having its annual conference. Some people make the mistake in thinking that it's a trade union organisation. It is not. It is part of the United Nations. And it is, in my view, basically institutionalised class struggle. It's the best way of understanding it. And this is a picture of the annual conference of the ILO. And what you find is down the left-hand side, down here, all these seats, right, are occupied by workers' representatives, us, right? Normally organised through the ITUC, but every country is entitled to send delegates to, the trade unions to send delegates to the conference. On the other side, down here, you have the employers. So every country has an employers' association, and they can send delegates to the ILO. And in the middle, these are all representatives of governments. Right? So we, as workers, have 25% of the vote, the employers have 25% of the vote, and the governments hold 50% of the vote. And what happens is generally like this. The workers stand up and they say, we demand that there should be a new international law which, I don't know, bans child labour. Makes it illegal to have child labour anywhere in the world. And the employers immediately will stand up and say, well, yes, of course, we don't like child labour, we think it's terrible, but we don't want a law about it. That would be terrible because, we don't like governments interfering in what we're doing. And also child labour is such a problem, it's deep-rooted in culture, and we really can't, you know. And so we disagree. We don't think there should be a law against child labour. And then, one by one, all the governments get up and state their case. So one government might say, well, we agree with the workers. We think that there should be a law against child labour. And another government will stand up and say, oh, we agree with employers. And then eventually they have long debates and so on, and then they vote at the end of it. Now, they've been doing this since 1919. Any idea why do you think the ILO was set up in 1919?
The economic crisis, wasn't it?
It was because the governments of the West and employers and some unions were very frightened by the rise of Bolshevism, by Lenin and all the rest of it, right? So they recognised that unless something was done at an international level to make workers' conditions better, right, we faced the possibility of a worldwide Bolshevik revolution. That's why they set up the ILO in the first place. So they've been meeting every year. I think during the Second World War they had a bit of a hiatus, but generally every year they meet and they talk about international labour law. And of course, some of the things that they first of all debated were very basic things, like the right to be a member of a trade union, and so on. But some of the things, they are really detailed, you know, like how old you have to be before you can be on a fishing vessel, or what health and safety equipment you need to be if you're a fireman, right, or whatever it might be. These are all debated at the ILO. Except that they can't actually pass laws. In reality, all they can do is pass recommendations, or what they call conventions. But then they depend on national governments to put them into their national legislation. And it has no army, it has no police force. Right? Its only weapon that it has is by diplomatically embarrassing people. By standing up from the platform and saying, we don't like this government. And the Brits among you, do you know the last time that the ILO was successfully took the British government on and got them to? Indeed so. Do you remember, those of us, those of you who are old enough, maybe you remember the GCHQ, no? General Communications Headquarters, yes. Which is the part of the defence establishment. And the Thatcher tried to ban trade unions then. And the unions took that case to the ILO, and it meant that from that podium somebody stood up and condemned the British government. Right? That's as far as they can go. But there's, of all the hundreds, and there are hundreds of different conventions and recommendations that the ILO comes up with, but they chose five what are called core conventions, core laws that they think that every government has to abide by. And that's simply freedom of association, that you, we, have a right to be in a union of our choosing. Simple as that. We have a right to be in a union, right? But B, we can choose which union we want to be in, or we can set up a union if we want to. We have the right to collective bargaining, so that employers, governments, and so on have to bargain with us. We form a union, we have the right to engage in collective bargaining. We are against forced labour. Now, many countries, that sounds a bit strange, but in many countries still, some countries still, you have people who are forced to work. For example, prisoners forced to work. Like in China, places, yeah? The effective abolition of child labour. We want to get rid of child labour. And freedom from discrimination of any kind, whether it be religious, gender, race, ethnicity, whatever. Right. So those are what are called the core labour standards. And they form a lot of the basis of the way that we work in the international trade union movement. Right. That is our core campaigning agenda, particularly freedom of association, has to be said. And decent work. So they also, in fact, did the decent work come from the ILO first or the ITUC first? The ILO came up with this first of all, this idea of decent work, which was taken up by the ITUC. Okay, so that's your very basic structure of the way that the international trade union movement has its institutions. If you were to go to an international trade union conference, you went to a global union federation conference, or a regional meeting, or a training session, or a summer school, what is it that you're going to hear? What are the things that people are talking about at the international level of the trade union movement? What are the agenda items that people in the coffee bars, in the bars, and over lunch, what are people talking about? Well, first of all, they're talking about the financial crisis or crises that we've been seeing over the years, and the emergence of some sort of new form of capitalism, and in particular, what we call the financialization of global corporations, where big, big transnational corporations are no longer interested in making bread or cars or whatever it is that they do. They are simply becoming like banks. And they are using their money in any way they possibly can to make more money. And by the way, when people tell you that there's not enough money to spend on so on and so forth, global corporations, big transnational companies, are sitting on huge mountains of cash. They have a lot of money. And they are, rather than spend that money on producing things, they sit on it and they use it just like, well, basically like a gambler, you know, in a casino. You're trying to increase the amount of money that you have in any way that you might need. So the financialization, and we'll talk, hear about that more, I hope, this afternoon and later on in the week, that is a crucial question that people are talking about. How do you handle this new form of capitalism? How do we fight against it? And what are the implications? Secondly, you'll hear people talking about the problem of Europe, particularly now. I wrote up this slide a year ago, right, before the Brexit debates and all the things that are happening in Europe and so on. Now, why is Europe such an important issue? It's an important issue not just for Europeans. That's the key thing. What Europe does still has an enormous impact on the international trade union movement as a whole. It is still where you find the largest numbers of trade unionists, largest numbers of trade union members, but you'll find also that the trade union movement is still very dominated in terms of leadership and thinking and so on by European leaders, inevitably. Partly because they got more money than anybody else, but not just them. But there's a major problem. First of all, there is this idea of social Europe, right, which has been around for a few decades, and this is an idea of we are in social partnership between trade unions and employers and governments, and we can all sit round and we're equals around the table and we can come together to make decisions collectively. That was almost true 2 decades or more ago when most governments in Europe were dominated by soft left or social democratic or democratic socialist governments who were by and large not necessarily hostile to workers and to the trade union movement. For the last couple of decades, we've seen a dramatic shift to the right, to much more conservative, dominated European governments. And that basically has torn up any idea of a social Europe. They're not interested in a social Europe. They're not interested in treating workers' representatives as their equals with government, with employers and governments. So that has collapsed. Yet, there are still a lot of people in the trade union movement, in Europe and beyond, who still hold to this idea that we're somehow part of a social Europe. Secondly, you've got what's called the European Trade Union Confederation and a whole number of what are called European Industrial Committees. So when the European Union was formed, or in fact before that, one of the things they did was to promote the idea of a European-wide trade union organisation, the ETUC. And in the same way as I've described the global union federations covering different sectors, there are in Europe different committees that run similarly for transport, for food, for public services and so on. But they are not necessarily part of the global union federations. So you get a disjuncture. You can get sometimes, let's use the example of PSI, Public Services International. It has a European counterpart called EPSU, the European Public Services Union, something like that. And they are not connected, right? They don't even hardly talk to each other. If you go to the website of PSI, you'll see no reference to EPSU. If you go to EPSU, you see no reference to PSI. So PSI globally might have one policy, EPSU might have something completely different. So it's really very difficult, and it makes PSI and a few others are, you know, very in a very difficult situation. Others are like the ITF, the transport workers, or the food workers. The European organisations are part of the global unions, but there's still friction. There's still a very big difference in style and policy between the European and the global organisations. That is largely because of the relationship between the union bodies and the European Commission. So if you're sitting in Brussels in a European trade union organisation, a lot of your day, in fact most of your day, is spent dealing with the European Commission. You're looking at Brussels governmental structures all the time. And you tend to not think about what's happening in the rest of the world. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, it is the European Commission that funds them, right? These organisations would not exist if it wasn't for money from the European Commission. They pay for all the air flights, they pay for the meetings, they pay for interpretation and translation and all that sort of thing. So, of course, the piper pays the tune, right? So if you're, what did I say, the piper pays the tune? No, who pays the piper? What's the term?
Anyway. Calls the tune.
Calls the tune, thank you. He who pays the piper calls the tune, that's right. So this is, and of course, with the shift to the right, and now even more with the crisis that's enveloping, starting from Britain and Brexit and so on, but also Greece, everywhere around the Europe, the political crisis, this is going to become a big issue. Right, yes?
Quick question. So can you only be part of the ETUC if you are a member of the European Union?
No.
Okay.
No, you can be, I'm not quite sure about how far it extends.
It extends all of geographical Europe.
So the whole of whole of geographical Europe, yeah.
Okay.
I think there are rules on, for example, if you're not a member of an EU country, there's some things that you can't get money for. You can only get money for some things if you are part of the EU. But in Britain, a little bit Anglo-centric, but in Britain, this was very important back in the times of Margaret Thatcher, when the unions were incredibly under attack by Thatcher and her government. And the European Union, which at that time was generally more to the left, held out its hand to the British trade union movement and said, come to us, we're friendly. You can work with us, you know, we'll protect you from these horrible Thatcherite policies. And so a lot of people, including myself at times, were very enthusiastic about working at a European level. But of course that's now all changed because it's the right wing that controls in the European Union. Okay. Migration, obviously, become, especially in the last few years, a major issue being discussed in the trade union movement. And just thinking about it a little bit, we're having hopefully a discussion this evening about migration, so we won't talk about this very much, but in general, I'm suggesting that there is a little bit of an agenda. First of all, there's a question about organising migrant workers. How do we effectively organise migrant workers around the world? Either in the place they're going from or where the place they're going to. But we've got to, you know, there are more and more migrant workers around the world, millions and millions. Unless we're able to organise them, they are completely vulnerable. Secondly, do we, as the trade union movement internationally, do we support the principle of free movement of labour?
Yes.
Do we think that workers should be allowed to go anywhere in the world they like? Clearly, this is a big, big issue in Europe at the moment, because a whole part of the problem is an argument about the free movement of labour within Europe. And of course, my instinctive view is, yes, of course we're for free movement of labour. But it's not quite so simple if you're a worker in a low-paid job and you feel that your wages are being undercut by employers exploiting migrant labour, bringing them in to take away your job. Mm-hmm. And we can't avoid that question. It is an important question. So there is a question about what do we do about free movement of labour. There's also, as a result of that, a rise, especially in Europe, a rise of racism and xenophobia. And the what I'm calling here the hyper-exploitation of migrant workers. This photograph, by the way, is of Chinese migrant workers within China. Right? So not all migration is between countries. And the biggest migration of all is within China. People from rural areas going to urban areas and so on. And these are migrant construction workers who were working on a site near Beijing. And they are sleeping out in the cold because they have nothing, because they were working on a construction site, and they simply, the employers just left and walked away without paying them anything and so on. And so they were just simply left abandoned on the outside to fend for themselves. So you've got what I'm calling the hyper-exploitation of migrant workers in many different parts of the world. I mean, we know about Qatar, do we know about the World Cup and the construction industry built on migrant workers from India and Nepal and so on, Bangladesh and all the rest of it. We know about it all over the world. So it's a big, big problem. And this evening what we're hoping to do is have a discussion about migration for people who are both coming from countries that are sending migrant labour but also receiving migrant labour. Okay, then obviously big issue which we're talking about properly during the week is the whole question of climate change, energy, and the relationship with the trade union movement. I'm sure most of you are against climate change. We want to do something about that. We feel that we need to protect the environment. We need to get rid of carbon emissions and so on and so forth. I wish I could say it was true for the entire international trade union movement. It's not. And there are many unions around the world who still may not be climate change deniers, but they are seeing their members' jobs under threat. Maybe in the mining industry, maybe in the construction industry, the car industry. Those industries which are polluters and are destroying the ozone layer and all the rest of it. But they are holding out for, but they're defending their workers and resisting resisting efforts to reduce the impact on the climate. So that's another live issue which we'll hear all about later in the week. The future of public services. We know, of course, that throughout the world we are witnessing privatisation of all sorts, nearly everything in terms of public services, especially in this country. You wouldn't believe the level of privatisation that's going on as we speak. But it offers the question, okay, if we had political power, what would we do? Would we simply return public services to central government control? Would we just simply nationalise everything? Or are there alternatives? You know, are there ways of running public services which are maybe through cooperatives or through people's ownership in other forms of public ownership? The rise of precarious work. Where's our friend from GMB? Hi. We were talking earlier on about, I was asking what he did. He said, well, I'm not quite sure. I'm doing a bit of this, I'm doing a bit of that, I'm trying to make a bit of money there. And, you know, this is, for most people in the world, the way that we have to survive. My father, right, was a teacher. And he died a few years ago, but he, he was able to, when he left university, when he left college, after being in the war and so on and so forth, he got a job as a teacher. He then had a job for the rest of his life. He had never had any thoughts that he wouldn't have a job. He was a teacher. He had a pension, he had health care, he had welfare state all around him. He was able to buy a house at the age of 26 or something from his salary. He was able to do all these things as a teacher. Now, today, although there are still teachers who've got pensions and so on, thank God, but most people these days don't have any form of security around the world in terms of not, you know, whether or not they're still going to have a job in 5 years' time, whether or not they have pension, whether they have health care, all these things. It's the rise of what's called precarious work all over the world. This photograph, I love this photograph. You know the company Hershey's, right, makes chocolate, an American company, right? This is a demonstration by young people who were working at Hershey's. Now, when I say working at Hershey's, they weren't actually working for Hershey's. What they did is Hershey's subcontracted, right, the production of their chocolate in this factory that they were working in to DHL. Right. And DHL then subcontracted the staffing of the factory to another temporary work agency in the United States. And that company then subcontracted it to an organization that was offering work experience for foreign students. And the foreign students paid, right, to go and have work experience in the United States. So they were paying to work in a chocolate factory. Now, in fact, this is extraordinary. I mean, this is an extreme example, but you know, this sort of thing happens all over the world. In fact, they won this. They all came out. The students were not stupid, and they came out on strike. And they called for and they got support from the local trade union movement, and they actually won the dispute. And eventually, the company was taken to court, and they were all paid compensation. But that gives you just a little example of what precarious work can be. But we're all facing it. We're all facing increasingly precarious work. And, of course, the far end of precariousness is what we call informal work. Most of the world's population works informally. They don't have an employer. They might have some sort of informal employer, but generally, they don't know whether or not they're going to be earning the following day, let alone the following year or 5 years' time. Mm-hmm. And we're having a long discussion, I hope, about informal work. It's something that GLI and our friends do a lot of work around. So it's one of our sort of main interests, is how do we work with informal workers? And the big issue for us, of course, is how we're able to organise informal workers into the trade union movement. Because up to quite recently, a very large proportion of trade union leaders in the world simply didn't think that informal workers had a place in the trade union movement. That you could only be in the trade union movement if you had, you know, collective bargaining with an employer as a proper contracted relationship. Of course, that's not true. Every worker has the right to be in the union, no matter what their employment relationship might be. This is a photograph from, I believe, South Africa. But it's just, you know, these guys are simply waiting at the side of the street for a day's work, if they can get it, saying, I am a painter, and somebody would drive along in the truck and say, right, I need a painter for the day, get them in the truck, off they go. Okay. The other issue, big one, is how do we, and this relates to the rise of precarious work and the rise of informal work, is how do we rebuild the trade union movement to reflect these changes in the structure of the labour market, really? And there's all sorts of unions around the world doing extraordinarily interesting things in terms of trying to reach out beyond its traditional base. So it's not just about 50-year-old blokes working in a factory producing widgets, right? It's how do you broaden out and into all sorts of other things. So these examples here of, for example, my own union, Unite, which is what runs what's called community membership, so people who are unemployed or semi-employed or informal can still be members of Unite. Or here, this woman is a tuk-tuk driver a tempo driver, it's called, in Nepal. Or a woman here who is a home-based worker in Bulgaria producing shoes for an Italian shoe company. If you buy, by the way, if you buy Italian handmade shoes, the likelihood is that this woman and her workmates working from home in southern Bulgaria would have made your shoes. Okay. The attempt to rebuild something of a trade union movement in Greece following the crisis in Greece. That's a poster from a factory occupation there. And so on, I could go on. And this, I mean, StreetNet International, an international organisation which is organising street vendors, market traders, of which there are millions in the world. So these are all efforts to rebuild or rethink what the trade union movement should look like, in one way or another. Then you have, very importantly, what we call an international organising agenda. You know, a few years ago, a few decades ago, I should say, the role of the global union federations and so on was really not much more than a post box or a telephone exchange. So the leader of one union in Germany wanted to talk to a leader of a union in the United States. And so how do I contact this person? You go through the global union federation. Very small, not much power, and all the real work was done by the affiliates, which is still, to a large extent, true. However, with the beginnings, the very beginnings of what we now call globalization, it began to have more, a bigger role than simply being a telephone exchange or a postbox. And in the 1970s, you first of all began to see the idea of what were called world company councils. And you had the beginnings of ideas of international shop stewards committees. So, for example, in the motor industry, in Ford, and General Motors, and so on, workers at a plant level began to think about how do they organise internationally, because they were, those of industries, that and chemicals and other big transnationals, were the first emerging truly global companies with global production lines. And so unions began to think, oh, how do we do this? How do we organise ourselves at an international level? And then in the 1980s, you have the beginnings of what we now call the internet, the beginnings of new forms of communication. And, you know, electronic mail and, what we now call the World Wide Web. All these things, when people began to think, well, how do we use some of that technology to organise internationally? The beginning of discussions around, is it possible to have some form of international collective bargaining? Is it possible that we, as a trade union movement in many different countries, can start negotiating with global companies? In the 1990s, you have the emergence of what we call international framework agreements, or sometimes called global framework agreements. And this is where companies who were persuaded or invited to sign agreements with global union federations to basically guarantee that basic rights for the workers in that company were to be respected anywhere in the world. So back to those what I call core labour standards, basically. So that a company, let's take an example. The first ever, which Dan signed, was for the International Union of Food Workers, with the company Danone, you know, the people who make yogurt and all that stuff, right? Big food transnational company. And the IOF negotiated the first ever international framework agreement with that company. And it basically said that wherever you work in Danone, if you're working for Danone anywhere in the world, you have the right to be in a trade union. You have the right to have collective bargaining. You have the right to be free of discrimination, and so on. And lots of other bits and pieces. But it was basically the first ever global agreement between a global union and an international corporation. There are now dozens and dozens of these that have been signed. Some of them are very weak. Some of them are little more than, not worth more than the paper they're written on. Some of them are treated like, you know the expression greenwash, when companies portray to be very green about the way that they treat the environment and so on and so forth. Well, the sort of union wash, right, where they sort of portray themselves as being very nice to workers and having unions and so on, but it doesn't really mean very much. But there are some which are very serious, and there are some agreements which are, you know, properly organised, so that, for example, you might have an annual meeting between the union at the global level and the company at the global level, where they talk about problems or whatever, and you have processes and procedures where if the union hears of a problem, let's say, you know, in a particular country, shop stewards are sacked for their trade union activity, then the union can raise that at a global level if it's not settled at a local level. And it does work sometimes. It does work. The global company often will then tell the management at a national or local level to reverse their decisions or whatever it might be. So that's been around for now a couple of decades and is still growing. But more recently, you've got much more aggressive forms of organising at a global level, where big global unions, like the transport workers, like the food workers, and so on, all the global union federations that we're talking about, will actually target companies and attempt to force them to the negotiating table to sign an agreement, or simply to be able to cope with the problems that are faced in that company. So we have now what we call global organising strategies, such as in the ITF, tackling the companies like DHL, which are all over the world, and how do you really get to grips with organising in those companies. Okay, you with me so far? I'm only 10% of the way through, no, I'm joking. Okay, big question, and this is where late at night in the bar, when you're in the International Trade Union Conference, or wherever it might be, these are the things that start coming up, right? Because we've seemed to have lost direction politically in the international trade union movement. If you go to look at the ITUC's website and look at its statements on things, it is incredibly bland. You would not believe that there's such a massive crisis going on in the world. It's still calling for social dialogue and for so on and so forth, when, you know, all hell is breaking out all over the place. And the small amount of politics there used to be historically in the international trade union movement has almost been reduced down to a level of lowest common denominator. But at the time, this is at the time when we actually need real political discussion. There's a crisis in social democracy. All over the world, the political parties which trade unions are historically and traditionally aligned with, the relationship between them and the unions is at best under strain, at worst completely falling apart. You name any country, virtually, but you know, Brazil, South Africa, Germany, Britain, America. The relationship between the political parties and the trade union movement is in crisis. And in effect, social democracy as a political movement is in crisis. And yet we need alternatives to neoliberalism, austerity politics, and so on. Do we see the trade union movement in movements like Podemos in Spain? No. Do we see them in Syriza? Not much. Do we see them in other new forms of political movements led by young people? Do we see the trade union movement visibly much in there? No, not much. Lucky if we do. Why? Why aren't we there? And do we have a democratic socialist alternative? I mean, this summer school and GLI itself, the GLI network, I mean, we are unashamedly democratic socialists. That's where we come from. That's our politics. And that's the starting point for our discussions for the whole week, actually. We assume, I think, that we all have, in the broadest sense, we might mean very different things by it, but we are broadly democratic socialists. Right? So what do we have an alternative? And what should the trade union policies be? What should the trade union politics look like, in our opinion? That's really the big question that we're here for. Okay, I'm going to finish with, I mean, I've been really rude about the ITUC, but I'm going to be less rude now, because, I mean, Sharon Burrow, who is the Secretary General of the ITUC, Australian Trade Unionist, Militant Trade Unionist, as she likes to call herself, even she says, and I'll read it, "We are not only losing collective bargaining rights. We are now in a labour war, effectively across Europe, the US, and emerging democracies. Why? Because the old stakeholders who drove the neoliberal economic policies that would seem to be foul policies, the Washington consensus, if you like, are back in control. We thought the global financial crisis showed them that this was a failed economic model. We were wrong. We have now a situation where we are largely engaged in what I can only describe as a labour war. And that's the head of the ITUC. That's strong words. So we're not alone in thinking there's a bit of a crisis going on. Okay, sorry.
Bernard Thibault, the former General Secretary of the main French National Centre, CGT, who is now in an ILO governing body, has just written a book called The Third World War and Social.
All right. Yeah, so there are people who really get this. Okay, that's the end of my little tour around what I think people talk about in the international trade union conferences in the bars and restaurants and so on. Those are sort of issues. And those are the issues that we're talking about this week, amongst others. So, questions, comments, thoughts, what do you want?
Just want to add that a lot of those issues are not necessarily discussed by the global labor movement. Like, for example, ITUC Asia Pacific would hardly touch on those issues that you said. So, just a clarification.
Why?
That's a good question. No, I think a lot of...
By the way, tell people who you are. Everybody
yes,
speak,
sir.
Please.
Sorry.
Say
my name is Joshua Manta. I'm from the Philippines and I represent Central. Unfortunately, we're a member of the ITUC, Asia Pacific. And the reason that, I think one of the main reasons for that is because ideologically, there's never been... the reason for that is that the ITUC Asia Pacific has never been ideological in the first place. It was a marriage of convenience, if you like, and it is pretty much dominated by the big unions of Japan and, well, primarily Japan, and the unions that they, you know, financially support. You know, so that's, I think that's the main reason. Anyway, I wouldn't want to add more into that.
Any other questions, comments? Yeah. So you are, Khalid.
Yeah, I'm Khalid Mahmood from Pakistan. I represent the Labour Education Foundation. It's a labour NGO. I think the problem is not at the regional or global level. The politics is not being discussed, or these kind of issues are not being discussed. The basic problem lies within the national level unions as well. The national level unions who are affiliated to the global federations are turning out to be more dependent on the money from the global unions, or more dependent on the projects that they are doing. The basic essence of the union membership, and to be reliable and to be to be based upon the membership fee and to be accountable to the members, that is missing, and that does not create ownership of the union for the members. And if that starts from the national level or the grassroots level, it goes up. And the global union federations are about surviving only on the project's money. You said the European Commission money is used by the European unions, and that's why they are moving around and they are this is not unionism, basically. The union has to be accountable to the members, and that can only be accountable to the members when they are surviving on the membership fee. And that is missing from the grassroots level up to the ITUC level. I agree.
Others?
Yeah. Oh, sorry. Sure. I'm just going to ask for a little bit of clarification on the two comments. Is it that...
Who you are?
Ben Hills, PCS, Commercial Services UK. Just sort of quickly, if I'm understanding, joining the two comments there together, that is it a case that in your respective regions, the countries that are economically contributing more to the unions, therefore controlling the agenda. So therefore, it's the issues of the Japanese unions that are funding the Asia Pacific funds, and the issues of other countries that are more funding them than unions, and therefore it's not the issues in all the constituent countries that are being discussed. That it's more the issues to do with one particular, more perhaps wealthy country.
Yeah, this is one of the issues, but I think the basic problem is not controlling the agenda from outside. The basic problem is controlling the agenda from inside. The leadership has become so bureaucratic in the trade union. Internal democracy is missing. And the leadership who is there, they are controlling the whole agenda of the trade union movement. And the agenda from outside can be tackled, I think, if there is internal democracy within the unions. The money is needed, of course, for the trade union movement, but how to channelize that money and how much are we dependent on that money of the governments, of the taxpayers, and coming through different institutions, how much we need to be dependent on that money. For us in Pakistan, for example, if we are internally democratic trade union movement, we can tackle the foreign agenda quite effectively, even if we are dependent a little bit on that. That is a political question that we can deal with and we can discuss and we can find out a way. But even within Europe, I mean, look at the bureaucratic structures of the union. Who is setting up the agenda for Europe itself?
Hi, Clara Pela from the PCS Union. And I just wanted to say, it seems to me like the traditional, you know, trade unions as we know them were built by mainly white men in manufacturing sector in Europe, and therefore they tend to like still represent this type of people. And they want to keep power. So we've talked about informal workers and the precarious workers, which in fact are most of people across the world, but trade union structure are still dominated generally by, you know, older white male. And we haven't talked about equality issues, but I think that it may be one of the reasons why they are reluctant to give power to other type of people.
Yes, just a
few. Who are you?
What is standing?
Who are you?
Oh, sorry. I'm Nidhal Kaki. I'm from Nepal. I agree with Brother Khalid, but there are which kinds of strategy we are organizing, or which model of strategy we are following that. This depends upon on that, like organizing model or service model.
Right.
Because if we divide it into organizing or service model, my experience is that service model is the better on that, to encouraging people to the unions during this period. Sure, I agree on that, but our problem is that we have some crisis everywhere in the union movement, so that if we follow that organizing service model, is better to encourage people inside the union. So what we this is my suggestion is that organizing service model is better than organizing model.
Thank you. We will be talking about this on Tuesday, when we're talking about the politics of organising and what about the difference between a service model and an organising model, which sounds very straightforward, but it's actually quite complicated. But we'll talk about that on Tuesday. Very good. Yes?
My name is Kamal Tiwari. I'm from India. Shipbuilding Workers Union. Then you may remember me.
Sorry, I didn't get the question.
But it's not a question, he's just introducing himself.
What?
It's not a question yet.
I didn't understand it.
Could you repeat what you said?
What?
He's introducing himself.
Okay.
Nothing. Thank you.
The problem that we realize in India, problem is inherent with the struggle itself. Actually, all the global trade unions, they have affiliates of the national trade unions. National trade union is a part member, affiliates of the political parties.
Right.
The parties who is in the power or in a queue to become a power. The government have their own agenda for globalization, imperialist globalization. So the national unions, they took part of their parties' line and they practices into the trade union field. In India, there is a new type of trade union is emerging. New type of a movement. See, we in worship building company in India, we form a federation with the support of AMRC friends here, sitting here. We have four worship making company in India. Not only worship making company, in different manufacturing units. You may have heard about this Maruti Suzuki workers struggle in India. This work, this movement is an independent movement. This worship federation which emerged is the independent trade union movement. So, if we are party to the national union, which is a constituent of the political party, there is a problem.
Those who don't, thank you, those who don't, maybe, particularly the British people here, you may not be aware that in many countries in the world, it is the trade unions were set up by political parties. So that you go to a lot of, and India is an extreme case, where you have many, many different unions representing many, many different political parties. Now, here in Britain, we have a somewhat different tradition, where actually it was the unions who set up the party, not the other way around. But a lot of countries, like the Philippines, we can talk about one. I think most countries in the world, actually, you were talking about trade unions divided because they are affiliated to different political parties. And, so, and that is a problem everywhere. Yes, sorry.
My name is Javad. I'm from the GMB Union and from England, 15 miles down the road, so that's a so just linking to what you're saying about politics and unions, just I don't want to be too Eurocentric, but going back to what you're saying about the European Union, about the way it's gone from, you know, a social democratic model to a neoliberal austerity model, I think the unions have a big role to play in dragging the European Union back to that, you know, social democratic or democratic socialist model. I know, for example, the GMB have certain MPs in Westminster who are union members, and that's, you know, a massive help in getting influence in the legislative process, because at the end of the day, if we want proper employment protections, we need a legislative solution. So, you know, I think we should always encourage our unions to, you know, involve in politically entrenched affiliate parties. I know it'll be, you know, a different situation across the world, like you were saying, you know, different parties have different unions. I think it's trying to create that unity under one banner, and that's when, you know, the unions can have proper, you know, legislative changes within countries.
Absolutely right. There's a difference between unions which are controlled by political parties. In other words, the party makes up the policy and passes it to the union. Or unions that make a decision democratically that they want to support a particular party or a particular political line. Big difference between the two issues. Mm-hmm. Yes?
Ross Oldenhaus from GMB. I just wanted to know a little bit more in your presentation about how national unions themselves get involved and why they get involved with international organisations that we're talking about. Because, just echoing Javad's point, it actually kind of links, I think, in Britain as a specific case, is about what industry sector you represent. And GMB, the general union, will see its aims being secured through legislative means, working with the Labour Party, working with national political parties, which often means that their political strategy seems to go between that and maybe the European Union, because we have a European office, whereas other unions like the RMT, for example, the sector-specific unions, will see its solidarity with the international world and will look to do through international organisations, perhaps a bit more because their sector is less impacted on perhaps by what the Labour Party is doing. I was wanting to know, is that something that is sort of echoing other countries? Is that sort of interesting sort of categorisation between different unions? Is that something that, that often drives national trade unions to go to international organisations?
It's a good question for you to ask throughout the week. You'll find out by talking to people, so yes, definitely. Yes?
I'm also from Germany, Kelly. I'm just obviously saying that these other trade unions owned by the sort of by the political parties, as you say. Is it the political parties that choose who the leaders of these unions, or are the lay members allowed to choose their own officers and organisers and hierarchy of the union, or is it the political party?
It's very different from country to country.
Because I mean, obviously, so that's what I think would be the first step to tackle, so that the lay members have that choice, so that they can.
Yeah. I mean, you have extremes. I mean, China, for example, it is the leadership of the trade union movement, so-called, is directly appointed by the state, by the Communist Party in China. Okay, and ordinary members have absolutely no say whatsoever in who the leadership is. Other countries, it's more complicated, where you might have political parties who exert influence in other ways. I mean, there's all sorts of different models. I mean, we can hear about that during the week. Lots of people here with lots of experience of different forms of the relationship between parties and unions. That's one thing we want to explore. Yeah.
Good morning, everybody. Shamir Brown from Jamaica Association of Local Government Officers. Quick comment. From what I'm hearing, it seems like the labor movement worldwide has an identity issue. It seems like from what I'm hearing, from the comments that I'm hearing from my brothers and sisters, the labor movement needs to find that focal point and stick to that focal point, because I think the lines are now getting blurred. You basically find a movement over here, a movement over there, and when you have that situation, there cannot be a true amalgamation of the movement if everybody has a different point of view, a different insight into how we deal with matters. Unless we can get that, and this is why I appreciate this this summer school, because I think it gives us this opportunity to try to find that central point, and moving forward we can focus on that. That's what
absolutely.
I'm saying.
Absolutely. We'll see if we can find this focal point. I mean, I think a lot of the global union federations are trying to find their way through that. I mean, as they have moved, as I said, from being basically a post office box and a telephone exchange into becoming actually like a union at a global level, you have to try and find, and not just satisfy everybody's individual needs, but try to develop priorities for a global union as a whole. Yeah. It's really tough, because you're having to deal with so many different, you know, if you think about the different contexts, different cultures, different politics, different all of the different problems that all different unions face, and trying to merge them together into having one central focal point is probably impossible. But it's a debate that's being held. I mean, there's a balance always in global unions about how much they are simply a federation and just enabling people to get on and do what they want to do, and how much they are trying to actually have a common program, which they do. Okay, any other points before we break for lunch?
Yes, I want to say.
Yeah.
My name is Erez. I'm from Wapman, from Israel. Actually, I work in East Jerusalem. Most of my work is with Palestinian workers. We also organize workers in the settlements. And as a huge part of my work is political. Of course, you cannot help Palestinians to get organized if you are not against occupation. And there was something missing about the talking about immigration. Work immigration, because
it's not only working patients, it's mostly refugees today. Between Syria and Yemen, there is a hell today. Most of the Middle East is in a big shift. You can call it almost the citizen war. You have the genocide in Syria, you have fascist regime in Egypt, and there is a great place to unions there. In Egypt, the unions have a great deal in fighting for democracy. The unions of the doctors, there is a very fascinating thing. So it's not only unionism, it's also today actually fighting for democracy, fighting against, you talked about the rising of the right wing in Europe, also the xenophobia. So it's part of that political change in the world. So I just want to say, because it's really make the work non-effective if you don't see it. You have to see the political problems when you are going to organize.
Very good point. It's true. We have not mentioned the role that unions play in, have done for centuries, in overthrowing dictatorships, in fighting for people's rights, and so on. And I'm very unfortunate, we hope to have somebody here this week with us from Egypt, from one of the unions that have been fighting consistently for freedom and liberty and so on in the last 20 years. Unfortunately, he was not given a visa to come to Britain like many others. But you're absolutely right, and it's an issue that we'll be raising. I mean, if you talk, half of the people in this room will know directly the role that the unions have had. Very good point. Okay, I think it's pretty well lunchtime.
Just saying 10 minutes.
Okay, good. Okay, yeah. Lunch is going to be in there.
You'll be there at the far end.
So lunch will be in the, just through there, the other side, you'll find there'll be lunch available in 10 minutes or so. Are there any final short questions? Yes, now Ben, yes, please do.
Hi, my name's Ben Sellers. I'm the guy with his head down most of the time. So apologies for seeming rude, but I'm the person that's doing a lot of the tweeting today for USI. So I've taken over.
USI, explain what USI is.
Yeah, so it's Union Solidarity International, and it's a kind of a sister organisation to the Global Labour Institute. I have a particular focus on social media and digital ways of organising. So I'm very interested in people that are also interested in that, and also people that are curious about that. And you'll see on the walls there the hashtag for the conference, so for the day, for summer school, ISS16. So if anybody does tweet, that would be a great start if people could start tweeting on that hashtag. If you don't know what I'm talking about, but you're interested, please come and talk to me, and I'd be more than happy to give myself a bit of extra work over lunch times and so on. If people, you know, want to maybe start up a Twitter account this week, you know, that would be great. We've already had somebody say, jump on this hashtag, which, by the way, is a good thing. That shows that there's some interest out there already. So yeah, please come and talk to me if you want some help, even if you want to do it this lunchtime. We'll be giving a little bit of an introduction to USI and what we're planning to do with that just after lunch, but I just thought I'd mention it before then in case anybody was desperately wanting to talk to me before then.
Great, thanks Ben. Okay, so that was a little bit, we haven't started the summer school yet. That starts at 1:30, we come back in here. That was just a little bit of a taster, a little bit of introduction to some of the things that we're going to be talking about during the week. I hope you found it useful. Okay, so let's Jess, is there any points that need to be made in administrative leave? No, we're all okay. Is everybody here? Near enough. I must say that there should be a further, I don't know, a dozen or so people who should have been here. We've had a real problem this year in the British government not giving visas to quite a few people, which is a great shame. Okay, anyway, have a good lunch, and we're back here at 1:30.